So we already heard Erik Kruse from Ericsson talk about how this infrastructure that reaches all over the world can help us solve problems and help people do better business and so on. And then we heard Mark Smith from KTH talking about how this world of Internet of Things is changing the role of engineers and how you need to expand your way of working and change it and design with new materials. But what I'm here to talk about is perhaps both from the designer point of view, the other half of the team, the people who are thinking about and interacting with people to try and figure out what it is that we want to do in this material, what it is that we want to achieve, and how we want to live our lives. You know, what is life really about, and what is it that we want to do in this technology? So I'm going to talk a little bit about this design material to give you a view of what a designer sees as the material that we're going to work in. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about life, what life is about and what we should be doing in these interactions. So first of all, I just want to say that Internet of Things is already here, and you're doing it all the time, every day. It's just that you don't think about it. So you go through the subway, swiping your card. You perhaps have bought a shoe with some accelerometer in the shoe that you can get to know how much you're walking. When you send something by snail mail, your package will be tracked. You might be one of those guys who put your iPhone under your mattress, and the iPhone then registers your sleep and tells you what your sleep has been and your sleep quality. You go to the store shopping for food, and you register all the stuff that you buy by using the barcode. You might have a wine cellar, and you make the inventory for your wine cellar using the barcode on the wine. You might go snowboarding. There are, you know, various fancy things you can put on your snowboard to give you a feedback on how fast you're going and how you're moving. Some might be putting this kind of strap on to register your pulse as you're jogging. You can scan and attach information to different places. You can have, I don't know if you use Foursquare, but you can actually log into different places using only your camera on your mobile. You can even just look at an object and use image recognition to figure out what that object is and get information about it. You can put other more advanced sensors on your body to register how much your emotional arousal is. And you can bump two mobiles together, bump, and thereby transfer one photograph from the other, from one mobile to the other. And there are even those that go hunting that put stuff on their dogs. So they'll put a mobile even on their dog, or at least a GPS, so that when the dog is running to get the prey, you will know when the dog stops, and that's where you need to go in order to shoot the elk or whatever it is that you're hunting. So this happens already now in Sweden. This is one of the studies from the Mobile Life Center that you can look up if you want to. So all of this is just connecting the world, locations, sensors, and so on, connecting that to the internet in various forms. And I don't think that when you do these things that you think about it as the internet. So internet, in a way, is becoming like electricity. It's just there, you know, when it makes sense, it's there, and you don't think about it as internet anymore. And I think what has happened, which is interesting and is about to change quite a lot, is something that we dreamt about as researchers in the 90s. And we called it, it's been called loads of different things. It's been called ubiquitous computing, ambient intelligence, and so on and so on. And what we were dreaming of is that every object would have some kind of network capacity, and then these objects would talk to one another. So I don't know if you remember this, but there were all sorts of trials of making your refrigerator talk to you so that you would be told that you need to buy some more milk or whatever. But that vision has changed, given that we've had two important changes in this world. And one is the cloud. So the cloud is there, and you have all your services in the cloud, and then you access them through different screens. You might access them from your mobile, for example, or from some other screen. So, but basically you have this cloud where all this information is converging. So really the Internet of Things is really about connecting stuff up to the cloud. and a lot of the time via mobile interaction. And so this is really the kind of environment, the kind of design material that we are working with. So we're connecting stuff through the cloud and with these sensors and actuators in the world. So living in this Internet of Things world, what is that then? So a lot of talking has been around machine-to-machine communication, making automation really, really quick, distributing electricity in our networks in an efficient way, building smart houses. I'm sure you've heard about Norra Djurgårdsstaden here in Stockholm, where all the houses are going to be so smart and so connected and so full of sensors and so on. And usually, those houses are kind of nightmares to live in. So I think one of the things that we keep forgetting is that this kind of technology is probably first going to be used not for these efficiency, problem-solving things, but instead for fun, for wellness, for games, for media, for life. This is where this technology will first be really utilized to its best extension, I think. I'm going to give you four examples of stuff that we have built that thrives on this environment, on this Internet of Things environment. By that I mean that on the one hand, it is a personal service that you use very locally, perhaps with some sensor on your body or with something that you see very close by. But on the other hand, that data and that information is sent up into the cloud, and then things are happening in the cloud that are then fed back into your local little situation. So let me go through these examples and I think it'll be clearer. So this one we built for the Stockholm Tunnelbana, that's the local transportation system in Stockholm. And for those who haven't been here in Stockholm, you should come and look. It's really fantastic art in each of these subway stations. And so they asked us, can we do something to get more, you know, so the users can get to know our art, because people are curious about it. And so they wanted to know, can we, you know, what do we need to build for doing that? But actually, you don't need to build much. All you need to do is to hold up the camera of your mobile to the piece of art, and then you can do image recognition on that piece of art. Now, as you know approximately where you are, because the mobile knows where it is, right? You can actually figure out very quickly which piece of art this is, and then upload loads of information. So here, somebody's holding up their phone to this piece of art, and then immediately, more or less, gets information that says Ingegerd Möller, blah, 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 did this piece of art, and so on and so on. So this is an example of using the big data in the cloud, image recognition based on loads of photographs that are up there in the cloud, for doing something that feels extremely local, extremely personal to me as I'm looking at this piece of art. Another example of a system that we built and that is now around is called Traveur. And I don't know if anybody's doing parkour. Parkour is when you jump around on buildings and do all sorts of tricks and stuff. So this application is helping people who do this parkour thing to find places in a city where they can do stuff that fits with their level of knowledge. So if you're a beginner, then you need to start with very simple stuff. And then as you move on, you can go do more and more advanced stuff. So this service is actually connecting the local to the global. So here you see somebody doing parkour. But if you're a beginner, how do you start? Well, you start probably at this level. And then you can have this mobile application that tells you, like, if you're a novice, then in this particular city, go to this particular place. And once you go there, you can videotape one another, and then you can upload it, and that video will be connected to that particular place. So here you see the video that they just took and uploaded. And then you can get information back from other people where they say, ah, look, you know, they did this cool trick at this place. And so here, you can learn together and you see some need to practice more perhaps than others. Some more training. Whoa. you can train together, and here you see that some are already a bit more advanced than others. Some have to struggle a bit to get up. Anyway, so the point of this particular system is that the information feels very local. So you get a video that really fits with the particular location you're at the same time as what the information is really in the cloud. And that's where we get all this video and all the stuff that you're doing. Yeah, so, I don't know. I think you need to train a bit before you go into these things. So let me give you another example. This is a system we built where we put sensors on your body. So we're putting sensors to register your sweat levels, and this is the same as you do in a lie detector. So you can see when emotional arousal goes up or down. We also register your pulse, so we can see when your pulse goes up because you're nervous, like I am right now. And it also looks at how much you're moving around. And then we transmit this data in real time via Bluetooth to your mobile. So you can look at yourself and your own physical well-being in the moment. You can take a deep breath and you can see how your pulse then goes down and so on. Now, this is a local service for you to look at your own data, but we also send the data up to a server, and on that server you can then get you can look at the data from many users, and you can feed back information to me as a local user about how other people react to different situations. So here you see somebody looking at her own data. In the middle is what is going on in her body right now, and then the data travels outwards. So you can see how here it's traveling outwards, how much she's been moving, and her arousal level at this point. And finally, a last example is to really drive in my point. This is a way of getting a local weathercast. So on the one hand side, you have the global weathercast that talks about the weather in Stockholm or whatever. But then you can put little sensors in your garden, perhaps especially in places that you love, like your summer house or a place like that. And those little local sensors connect to one another, and then they connect to the internet. And then you can use that to get a local weathercast. So you can log in to see how is my summer house doing, what is the weather locally in my garden. So coming back to this, so what we're doing in all of these examples is that on the one hand, we are using the local, the very, very local, the sensors, the actuators, the stuff that we can feel and touch locally. And on the other hand, we're thriving on the big data that this generates into the cloud and feeding that back. So you can feed that back in various forms. You can find patterns in people's behavior. You can feed it back in social media for people to comment on your health levels or whatever. You can use it as social navigation, finding the places where other people have done their parkour tricks. You can use crowdsourcing as a way of populating a space. You can have smaller groups that interact and use this data as friends. So, coming back to my initial point of this talk, what is it that we want to do in an Internet of Things world? This is both amazing and fun, and you can see all these great, great applications that will make life more interesting and fun, both locally and as you're moving around a city and so on. And in a sense, what we are doing with this is that we are taking data from reality, from your body or from your camera on your mobile, registering what is about around you. So on the one hand, we're taking this reality, and then we're sort of putting a narrative to that and selling it back to you. This is what we're doing, in a way. So we're medializing reality. And I think a lot of the times people want to move out of the virtual worlds and make the virtual worlds more connected to the real world, to the local, to what is going on right here, right now. So as you may know, some people are quite tired of shallow relationships in Facebook or that kind of interaction. So they're looking for something that is closer to where they are, that is meaningful to them. And in doing so, in using this kind of technology, you are, in a sense, constructing yourself and you're constructing your reality. You are telling stories about yourself. So one of the big worries I think that people have is that with all this data, is there going to be any privacy? When am I going to be able to log off and be outside this world? And actually what is happening, what we can see happening with the kinds of applications we're building, is that it's not really that big a problem. what people are doing is they're choosing when to show that they are at a particular location or that they're doing particular things. It becomes part of how they dress their digital selves and portray themselves to others. So living in this Internet of Things world is very much performance. You perform yourself through these media. You act out who you want to be in these interactions. So I don't want to downplay privacy. Of course, it's important and very difficult, but I think it's also something that we solve in interaction with ourselves and with others. So by that, I finish.